Tov. Shana Tova, everyone. Someone that comes in a fast day to hear Divrei Torah, I just show you how much he loves Hashem. Usually this time, most people are completing, missing sleep from the year. It's easy to fast when you sleep. The idea is to feel the stomach grinding. We are in Aseret Yemei Teshuva. Hope your Rosh Hashanah went well. Many people ask in Aseret Yemei Teshuva, what's the point of being extra righteous for a week, Rabbi, and I know that I'm going back to my old ways anyway after Yom Kippur? Isn't it hypocrisy? What's the point? I have to work on myself eventually to get better and better, but for good. What is the point now? All of a sudden, 1 week I'm extra tzaddik, all of a sudden I'm makpid chalav Israel in Aseret Yemei Teshuva, extra teilim, extra, extra, extra. Then I go back to what I am. So it's really like filling up the bucket and then kicking it. No, good question, no? What do you think? So the answer is, logically, you're right. Halachically, you're wrong. Baruch Hashem. Why? Because the Shulchan Aruch himself said, clearly, the Jewish Book of Law, what does it say? That in Aseret Yemei Teshuva, they have to be extra righteous. That's the whole point. The Ari HaKadosh says that Aseret Yemei Teshuva, it's really seven. Take off the 2 days of Rosh Hashanah. Take really the 1 day of Yom Kippur. What leaves? It leaves 7 days. 7 days, each day of the seven fix the entire year. So means Sunday now, fix all the Sundays of the previous year. Mondays, fix all the Mondays. Tuesday, all the Tuesdays, until you come, and it fix the entire thing. Which means, this is an opportunity for a person to actually save something out of the missing year. Imagine if a person doesn't do this tshuva right now, when will he be? I spoke in my lecture before Rosh Hashanah that the Gemara say that there are three books are opening up on Rosh Hashanah. Tzadikim, Reshaim, Benoniim. Righteous, wicked, mediocres. Righteous, we are not. In case you think we are, think again, we're not righteous. We have plenty of problems. Just walking on the streets in Manhattan 1 hour, you cannot be righteous. There's no way to be righteous. Walking in Sodom and Gomorrah. Lot, when he moved to Sodom, right away he lost his level. Right away, as soon as he moved there. So therefore, to think that, oh, I live in this world, I merge, I work, I do everything as usual, and I keep Shabbat and Kashrut, very nice. It's a very nice level. But to call it tzaddik, it's not, unless if you're Rabbi Ashri, Zecher Tzadik Livracha, that lived in Lower East Side, and he walked all his life with his face in a wall and of a ground, never picked up his face, that's a different story. That means you're here, but you're really not here. Because really the idea is that Chazal said that the person is where his mind is, not where his legs are. Most people, you look at someone with his legs, he's right here, but his mind is somewhere else. You know, the Gaon Mivilna, when he accidentally one time touched Mukhtse on Shabbat, he fainted right away. How many Jews you know today that touch Mukhtse and they faint? I know people while they're playing with the Mukhtse, they're telling jokes. That's what I know. Gaon Mivilna, he touched Mukhtse by mistake one time, realized what happened, right away he fainted. Perfect human being. Age 9, he already knew all the Torah. What, you're comparing us to the Gaon Mivilna? Come on. Be reasonable. So the answer is, not only, we're not in talking about the level of righteousness. Why? Because the Ari told his student, Rabbi Chaim Vital, that a person judge also compared to the generation that he lived in. You understand? So therefore, we still have a chance. Why? We live in one of the worst generations when it comes to modesty in history. And there are so many different kinds of sins are happening, billions and trillions of sins in the world every second. And it's a very, very big wonder how HaKadosh Baruch Hu can stand this world. in our little mind, it's a very, very, very big kashya, very, very hard kushya, strong question. How HaKadosh Baruch Hu can stand such a dirty world? Look, 7.4 billion people, almost everyone idol worshiper, fake religions, fakes, so many fake people, so many angry people, so many liars, so many crooks, so many thieves, so many prostitutes, so much lack of modesty, and all of a sudden there's a little island of 1 million Jews who try to do their best to live according to the truth. That's it, 1 million from 7.4 billion, and Hashem can still maintain the world. It's a very big wonder. Big wonder. Because you may think, oh, maybe Hashem also take to consideration other religions, you know, like Islam, Christianity. Some people willing to die for their foolish religion. They're willing to die for it. So maybe Hashem also take it as a mitzvah. The answer is absolutely not. Not only that these people who fast in Ramadan, or that they do all kinds of Christian holidays, not only they won't get a reward, they will get punishment for every law that they kept on their phony religion. They're not gonna get reward for it. When the Muslim decide that you have to fast now, and you have to do this, and you have to do that, they will get punished for that. Because they did it based on a false prophecy, a lie. And the Torah says clearly, what even if the Navi, even if a prophet comes and say the truth of God, but he say, Hashem told me to say it, and is a false prophet, like their Muhammad, or like all the other books that the Christians wrote. This is a false prophecy. Even if it's aiming to the truth of HaKadosh Baruch Hu, the prophet has to be put to death. And the people who follow him, with him, going directly to the garbage. So what are they gonna get? So that's definitely not mitzvot. It makes Hashem even angrier. It's people think, oh, you know, look, they're strict, they're willing to do certain things. They're going to get punished for that. They're not going to get a reward for that. Only someone who follows the emet of Hashem because Hashem said so, like we say in the morning, Lama en ma'arvim badvash, we say, Im natan tane bar kapara, tane bar kapara, ilu naya adam noten bakortov shel dvash, in a ktoret, if you mix honey, אין אדם יכול לעמוד מפני ריחה. The smell of it, it's unbearable. So, therefore, nobody can put honey in it. When honey, you burn the honey or whatever, it smells, such a smell that it's unbearable. And right after that he say, ולמה אין מערבים בדבש? And why you don't put honey in it? You just told us. The smell is horrible. What are you now asking why we don't put, you just told us. To teach a very big message. Even though it's because of this, it's because of that, you can find hundreds of excuses. Lama en marbim vadash mipnei shatora amra ki chol seor vechol dvash lo taktiru bimeno yishel Hashem. Not because it's logical, not because the pig, it's dirty and he eats the diapers of the babies and he eats all rotten things and it does not digest in his stomach for 24 hours and it's unhealthy, not because of that. Why we don't eat it? Because Hashem said not to touch it. That's it. That's the bottom line. Why Hashem, why we don't do this, why we do that? The answer, always the same answer, because HaKadosh Baruch Hu say to do or not to do. That's it. So now, I started to explain. The Gaon Mivilna, he touched the Muktzeh, not only because he was in a very high level, he fainted. That's one thing. Just one generation ago, when people heard the word Elul, people heard Elul. They announced Rosh Chodesh Elul in a shul. Half of the people were faint. People were fainting. Wow. 30 days to the judgment day. Where will I start, Bechlal? You know, so today when I say Elul, a person is worried. Oh, I didn't build my sukkah yet. I'm busy. You know, all the sukkots are ready already. Ma, what's the rush? Right away, before Rosh Hashanah. Ma, the same from Yom Kippur. Right away, you start putting the sukkah on, you're moving from one mitzvah to another. But already, 2 weeks before Rosh Hashanah, you feel sukkot already in the street. Why? That's what the people in their mind is, instead of focusing on the tshuva. So it says like this, the Gaon Mivilna, because he knew all the secrets of the world, how everything falls into place, every little screw in the system, the engineer, you see, somebody idiot like us. If we see a huge machine, a huge computer, a robot, It's worth, I don't know, $50 million, special, made in Japan. They worked 3 years to assemble it together. So many different systems. Somebody like us see a little screw somewhere. And he think, or a little plug, tiny plug, like a USB plug. And he's thinking, compared to such a big machine, what is this? You play with that, take it in, take it out. You don't understand. Who would faint when you do it? The engineer, the one who built everything. He knows what every little piece in the system, how important it is for the whole system. When someone knew all the secrets of the creation, all the malachim, all the olamot, if you read Adir Bamarom of the Ramchal, little bit you read, not that you understand anything, but the little bit that you read, you say, wow, we live in such darkness. So there's so much to learn. Where would we ever learn it? We live a million years, we won't finish it. And these people did it in a short life, 30, 40 years, they finished everything. How did they do it? One of the explanations is the world was very clean. The world is clean. There's nothing to do besides learning, not all the entertainment and the garbage that we live in. So obviously, pure your mind to focus nonstop, and you're constantly doing the same thing. You are focused. You grow in a very, very high level. If you're in and out, it's like boiling water. Put water on a fire, you take it out, on, off, on, off, on, off. 10 years later, the water never boiled. But if you put it constantly, X amount of time, it gets to such a level, from there on, it's very easy. That's the concept of coming into the shul, 47th Street, yeshiva, 47th Street, shul, 47th Street, Sdom, Yerushalayim, Sdom, Yerushalayim, Sdom, Yerushalayim, all your life, Sdom! Age 40, age 90, doesn't matter. What did you achieve in your life? But we see people who give up this nonsense. They focus, they close themselves for many, many years. Like Rav Eliashiv, 60 years, was standing next to one stander all his life. Why do you think he become like him? What do you think? Just to know Torah? It's not enough just to learn to know Torah. We see the focusing, the devotion, giving up everything this world has to offer for knowing for the most important thing in the eyes of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. There's no such thing, you're not going to get to a high level. This is the problem today that we live in. So now we are now in Aseret Yemei Teshuva. One of the things in Aseret Yemei Teshuva is to accept Kabbalot, to accept on ourselves, to do things better. I started to explain the Sifrei Chaim, the Sifrei Tzadikim, the Sifrei Reshaim, and Benonim. Tzadikim, we already know right away Hashem signed them Lechaim. Reshaim, Lamavet. We're not talking life here. Because many Reshaim live here and they live and kicking and make money and everything is fine by them. They're not even sick. So what happened? 30 years already in a row, they get signed for Lamavet and they're still running and making money. Well, where is Lamavet? Where? And many Tzadikim, they signed Lechaim, and then after that, they passed away. So where is the Lechaim? The answer is, of course, we're not talking about Chaim v'mavet here. We're only talking life and death of eternity. If you were dying today for good, would I sign you for the book of life of eternity or for the book of life of Chas v'Shalom, Deraon Olam? Deraon Olam. Like the Gemara in Rosh Hashanah says, page Tetzain, I believe. So, this is it. Now the Benonim, hope we are Benonim, hope. Why? I tell you why. Gemara say Abaye and Rava, they ask, who is Benonim? Who is mediocre? They say, Kegon Ana, like us. They say, us? We learn Torah nonstop all our life, can revive the death from the grave. We are Benonim. In that case, Lo Shavik Chaye Lechol Bria, you did not live life for anyone. If you call us Benonim, they knew the real level. So the answer is, yes, in their time, they considered themselves Benonim. In our time, they were way, way, way above Tzadikim, in our generation. If they live today, there's nothing to compare. All the Chachamim would hide. If Abaye and Rava would be today, do you think any Rebbe would open his mouth, Bechlal? Say, Rebbe, Rebbe, give us a Dvar Chizuk L'Rosh Hashanah. I say, excuse me, don't call me Rebbe. What, you calling me Rebbe and you call Abaye Rebbe? It's the biggest crime. How can you call me Rebbe when you have this Mechayem Etim here? All the rabbis would hide. Why? Busha. It's even an embarrassing thing. You know, it's like, I'll give you an example. Somebody in a community here, he made $10 million, $20 million. Everybody gives him respect. Ashir, Gvir, wow, he made it in business. But one day, if you move this Ashir to a close community with Bill Gates or Warren Buffett, all the real Ashirim, and then his cousin would come and say, my rich uncle, he says, shh, don't say it too loud. Over here, I'm very poor. I compared to them, you're calling me rich. Over there, in Rigo Park, I was rich. Over here, shh, don't, I'm the cleaning guy. I serve the tea over here. You understand? Same thing over here. If they leave today, they say, the biggest tzaddikim. But in their time, they consider themselves benonim. This is what the Ari Sera B'Chaim Vital, that it's go based on the generation. Iftach bedoro keshmuel bedoro. Iftach wasn't in a level of Shmuel HaNavi. Shmuel HaNavi was very big tzaddik. Iftach wasn't nothing near him in his level. But according to his generation, his status in Shamayim, not only here, in Shamayim, was exactly like the status of Shmuel in his generation. And Shmuel was a big Navi and Tzaddik in a generation of David HaMelech, Natan HaNavi, great people. And Shmuel, still Chazal comparing him to Moshe Aaron combined. Shmuel, there's no understanding in his level, Bechlal, Shmuel. One of the advices how to pass in a din, because remember, hopefully we are Benonim, hopefully. That's by, you know, giving us too much credit, maybe we Benonim. So if we are Benonim, meaning we come three times to shul every day, we learn in every open minute that we have, we don't steal, we don't talk Lashon Hara, we're not making all kinds of sins out there, you know, in not tzanua places, we don't have television at home, we put tefillin every day, we have tzitzit ktana under the clothes, and we walk with kippah without being embarrassed, and, you know, we watch the eyes, and we love Hashem, and we believe in only Hashem, we don't follow any idols, and we give a lot of tzedakah. If we do all this that I mentioned, and a few other things, maybe we are benonim, if we are benonim. Now, if we are benonim, that means now every day of our life, right now, in the next few days, it's critical. It's critical how a person can even walk. I'm asking myself. If I knew, if Hashem told me in Rosh Hashanah, you are Benoni, I'm testing you in the next week, would I be able to go to work? How can you go to work? The life of eternity is on a line. You have time to sell gold or to sell Persian rugs? How can it be? If a person now is preparing to a major trial, would he be able to go to the office as usual? He won't be. A month before the trial, he doesn't come. Mr. X is very busy with his trial right now. Please do not disturb him. His phone will be off all month. Why? Who has time to waste? That's called Benonim Omdim Vetluim. They're hanging. Now every little move, boom, Hashem push him to the negative side or to the positive side. And what happened if he dies this year? If he passed the 10 days, Aseret Yemei Teshuva, in a positive side, and then he died, that's it. He made it for life. And Chas V'Shalom, if he died and he didn't make it in Aseret Yemei Teshuva, he just lost everything. It's critical. It's not jokes here. So the question is, how does a person able to overcome such a critical and pressure, it's very pressuring to live in constant pressure, how does a person make the Aseret Yemei Teshuva positive? So we have a great advice that Chazal gave us, which I'm sure you heard many, many times. Kol ha-ma'avir al midotav, ma'avirim lo kol pshav. Someone who is forgiving, who is not too strict when people did something wrong to him, he let go, he forgive easy, he doesn't make a big deal. He doesn't judge people the way they should be. He let go. He feel mercy on them. He say, oh, you know, poor guy. You know, look at him. Look at his level. What can you do? No. Things like that. Some people, they're very, very strict. every little thing, he comes to his son. Why you did that? Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? 16, adios. Adios, padre. Goodbye. Why? I had it. Know when to be, when not to be. It's also very difficult. So what happened here? Rabbi Akiva, the Gemara said, Rabbi, in Masechet Ta'anit, the Gemara said, Rabbi Akiva said, Avinu Malkenu, three times the rain started. The Nasi said, Avinu, the Nasi made Ta'aniot, people are fasting, no rain. Rabbi Akiva came, Rabbi Akiva from a family of converts, Rabbi Akiva said, Avinu Malkenu, Avinu Malkenu, Avinu Malkenu, rain began. Everyone already prepared their grave. Nothing to eat, nothing to drink. So everybody say, Rabbi Akiva should be the president. It's not fair. Our president didn't help us a lot. Here this Chacham came, 1, 2, 3, rain came. Who deserved to be the king? He deserved to be the king. Well, what's going on? It's not fair. So the Gemara say, no, it's not greater than him. But why? It's Ma'avir al Midotav. Ma'avir al Midotav. Torah, they both very big. Knowledge, they very big. Modesty, very big. But there's one thing Rabbi Akiva has that it's a very, very big bonus. What is it? Ma'avir al midotav. He doesn't hold revenge, he let go, he doesn't have a grouch. He's a comfortable person to deal with, which means it's very hard to put it in English, these words, ma'avir al midotav. I'll give you a few examples. Maybe by the examples you get the point. First, we should know one thing. The Gemara says Rabbi was the president of Israel. He got like stones in his kidney. Stones, you know, it's very painful. So servant, when I scream, give food to the horses. Let the horses, because when you give food to the horses, they make a lot of noise, like in McDonald's. Lots of noise. Where is my head? Where is my food? Or, you know, when they serve the food in parties, see how much noise there is? Hey, excuse me, over here, you skip our table. Everybody screams. The food, you saw when they bring the food in a wedding, the dessert, what happened? All the dancing immediately ceased. Shh, everyone like a magnet to the side of the dessert. Why? The food has a very strong power. So the horses, when they give them the food, they make a lot of noise. So they said, Rabbi said to his workers, make sure that the horses make noise when I scream. I don't want to upset the people that pass by. They hear that I'm in suffering. People feel bad. So the Gemara say, why Rabbi got this pain? Because one time a calf came to him, a calf that was on the way to be slaughtered. So he pushed him. He said, why are you trying to hide by me? Go. You were created to be eaten. Go. So he pushed him away. 13 years later, how the pain left Rabbi, that he saw that the maid, she sweeped the floor and there's little rats. And she makes them fly like she's thinking she's playing golf, you know. She makes them fly. And he said to her, hey, what are you doing? V'rachamav al kol ma'asav. Hashem has mercy on every creature he made. That day, the pain and the suffering of Rabbi immediately stopped. Why? Mida keneged mida. You didn't have mercy on the animals, you got the suffering. Tzar ba'alei chayim, d'oraita. Now you fixed it, which means you showed that finally you have feelings for the poor animals that are going to suffer. The pain went away. I want to ask you, 13 years of Chodesh Elul. Rabbi also sang, Chatanu lefanecha, Anenu avinu. Rabbi didn't say slichot? Rabbi didn't make tshuva in Chodesh Elul? He didn't do tshuva, Rosh Hashanah, Kippur, Aseret Yemet tshuva? He did not learn Torah all year? It wasn't enough? 13 years? 13 Elul. 13 times 40 is how much? 520 days of tshuva with slichot. 520. What about Aseret Yemet tshuva and extras and all the Torah and writing the Mishnah and be mezakeh Arabim? What happened to all that? Wasn't enough for pushing a little calf? Wasn't it such punishment? 13 years of screaming? Do you know the pain? I don't wish you this. I saw one time a person in his kidney, small stone in his kidney, small, that the doctor told him, drink a lot, it comes out. If you drink a lot. If not, then we're going to have to do laser. But drink, don't worry, most likely it would come out, which means it's very small in the x-ray. And you should see the pain he had, fever, pain, suffering. This is suffering of 13 years, suffering. What do we see from here? Slichot without tshuva, it's worthless. Singing in a choir, Miami Boys Choir. Chatanu, what is this chatanu? Chatanu, your heart is broken, you feel chatanu? You feel avinu, you feel pashanu? You feel all these things, ganavnu, gainu, all these things? You feel it or you just came to sing in a choir? Huh? You know, I knew a guy, not religious. Every year, a few days before Rosh Chodesh Elul, he used to call me, he said, tell me, when the Slichot is starting this year? So I said to him, Thursday. Why do you care? What time? I say, 6:30. Where? Give me the address. Mechalel Shabbat, Boel Nida, Eat Reif, all day lie, all day still in a business, arrogant person. You don't know who he is, so I can tell you the whole list. And he calls every year to ask for slichot. So one time I asked him, why do you care about slichot so much? You keep one Shabbat, it's better than million slichot. Million days of slichot won't be equal to one Shabbat you keep. Why you care so much about slichot, I told him. So he told me, I love the music, the songs. We're laughing. You're laughing at him? Imagine if the slichot wouldn't have song. How many people would show up? If the Slichot wouldn't have beautiful Zmiros. It's nice singing. It reminds people about their childhood in Yerushalayim, in a Bukharian neighborhood, the great Chazanim. It's very nice. It always starts with lots of people coming first week, second week a little less, because people got tired of the music. You know, you hear the same song every day. It's not as exciting. But what about the tshuva? We do everything right. But the most important thing, so Rabbi, which was a giant chacham, Hashem did not take away the pain until he fixed the specific problem. The specific problem. When you don't fix the specific problem, it's just not forgiven. I give you an example. Many people, they learn very nice Torah. They really learn. They go to yeshivot, they learn. But what happened to them? After a while, they already feel that everyone around them is, like they say, ashkal. You know what ashkal means? Baruch Hashem, there's no Persians here. Yeah, it's like garbage. Yeah, garbage, no. That's how they feel. You feel the way they talk to you, or they come to the restaurant, how they talk to the cashier, how they talk to the waiter, how they talk, they think that they're the elite, superb, VIP, Chashuvim, Chashuvi Yid, the Oilam, Chashuvi Yid. We are, the world is thanks to us. Which is true, by the way, the Torah maintained the world. But one thing HaKadosh Baruch Hu hate the most is ego, pride. Pride, pride. All the show of, you are there and I'm here, you are there and you stay there and you talk to me like you're there and I'm here. That's the way they are. But it's not only to strangers. It's also to their parents. It's also to their own brothers. And eventually, it's going to be against their own rabbis also. Why? Ego, pride. Pride is a cancer that you have no idea how horrible it is. Ego and pride. If a person used the Torah to become a monster, what good the Torah did in the world? If before you had the Torah, you had nothing to be proud of. Now all of a sudden you became chacham after 10 years of learning. Serious, you learn. You have devotion. You get up, you learn, you don't waste time. You're very serious in your learning. But you became a monster. That's it. You look at everyone down. That's very dangerous. Gval lev oto lo uchal, Hashem says. Someone with ego, high, his nose is up. I cannot stand him. I cannot be in the same place with him, in the same place. This gava, you know, I tell you something. In the previous generation, in Europe, there was the Haskalah movement. Haskalah movement, they started to push people to academic, to colleges, and they started to challenge the Torah like we are better. We are nothing less than you. You're learning, learning, learning. We also learn. We go to universities. We're going to become doctors and lawyers and engineers. And all of a sudden, it was big rifyon, which means lots of Talmidei Yeshiva, they didn't feel anything special. They looked down at them. All of a sudden, the secular people, the communists, all these, they started to look down at them. So in Yeshivot, they realized, if we're not going to make them understand the value of Torah, everyone would leave the Yeshivot. Because a person wants to feel achievement. If he doesn't have an achievement, he doesn't feel satisfaction in what he does. You have to give him a goal, satisfaction. So what happened? They started to make everybody else look like a monkey. You compare him to you, doctor, lawyer. And then he went one generation, two, three, four, it became in a system. We are here and everybody else is nothing. But that was necessary back then to reserve the yeshivot. But today what? Nobody challenged you. You want to sit, you learn Torah, you sit and learn Torah. He wants to be a doctor, let him be a doctor. It's his business. It's not coming to debate you. I'm better than you, I'm smarter than you. No. If you invite him to the yeshiva, after 15 minutes, he falls asleep. No matter how great of a doctor he is, or a lawyer, or whatever he is, he's not going to be able to learn in a level of Gemara. You give him one page of Gemara, he's going to say to you, I thought I learned hard things. Now I understand that there's nothing to compare between me and any of these serious bachurim that learns Gemara. It's nothing to compare. All you have to do is invite him one day to the yeshiva. Right away, we'll admit. Right away. He will tell you right away, what, do you compare what I learned in college to what they learn here? Give him one tosfot. Not hard. An easy tosfot. To understand the kushiya and to understand the terutz. Give him hours. And you even help him, you assist him. And he's going to say, wow, it's very, very deep. It's very, very deep. You know, one of the ways, one person that was by me for Rosh Hashanah, he told me something very clever. It's this Hasid. He said to me, really, really, if a person learned Gemara serious, he never have questions about Borei Olam. It cannot be. Why? But just by reading the Talmud, how it was designed, how deep it is, you say wisdom like this does not come out of nowhere. It has to come from a divine source. There's no other way. No, people cannot create such wisdom. It has to be something above human. And to remember all of that with no contradiction, there's nothing even to begin to understand what we're talking here about. So the idea is, remember, if you are a very, very big scholar, but you have ego, and you look at everybody, that's what the greatness of Rav Ovadia, that no matter how great he was, when he gave lecture to the Baalei Batim in Yerushalayim, some of them hardly read Hebrew. He was telling them stories from the Talmud, like little kids, telling them stories, it is Yosef Mokir Shabbat. What is that? This is every beginner. 2 months in yeshiva, he can teach this. Why are you taking the most important chacham and make him teach Baalei Batim these things? Why? I was being humbled. You don't feel you nothing. You're just speaking to them in their level. Mamash, with no problem. He never said, why do I need this shiur? It's a waste of time for me. I should teach in the highest level of yeshivot. What am I doing here, giving the Shabbat lecture here, all the Baalei Batim? Every little kid can teach. His little son was bar mitzvah. He could give this lecture. It wasn't something that, you know, in a very high level, halacha. Yeah, and when it comes to yeshivot, he gave in a higher level. But to speak to these people in their level, not that many gdolim were able to do it. Some gdolim say, I can't speak to them in their level. I cannot speak in this level. I just can't. I feel like I'm burning my time. But it's coming from being down to earth. I remember one woman went to him, and she said, Rabbi, I came to ask you for mechila. I spoke Lashon Hara about you because of the politics and this and that. Please forgive me. So he said to her, why did you bother coming all the way here? Ma ani, ma chayai, who am I? Why you wasted your time? Machula, he started to give her brachot. Not only he wasn't angry that she was speaking Lashon Hara at him. Some people get angry. Oh, you want mechila? You tell me exactly what you spoke about me. I need to know. It makes you humiliate you. It makes you embarrassed. No, Rabbi, let's not go into detail. No, 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 my friend. You want mechila? I need to know what damage you made me. Ma, who knows how much money I lose because of you? Who knows how many people don't come to the lectures because of you? Who knows how many people throw my CDs to the garbage because of your lies? Why should I be mochel you? That's really the right way. Gemara say, kol talmid chacham she'eno nokem ve'noter kenachash she'eno talmid chacham. But when you reach such level of modesty, of being humbled, humility, you're so humble, these laws doesn't apply to you anymore. It's your nature. It becomes your nature. You feel you're nothing. Ma, who am I? Ech Moshe Rabbeinu say, what am I? Va'anachnu ma? What are we? We're nothing. Avraham Avinu say, Anochi afar va'efer, I'm dust on the ground. David HaMelech say, Anochi tola'at ve'lo ish. Right? Moshe and Aaron say, we are nothing. And Nebuchadnezzar say, I'm God. Paro say, I'm God. I am. The Reshaim, they always think there's something special. But the people who reached the highest level, they were down to earth. Mamash, like nothing. The Ramchal, he was hiding himself. Only very few people knew who he is. That's why he had so many people fight against him. What are you teaching Kabbalah, this, that, tikkunim, ichudim? He got very angry. It made him suffer a lot. Today, the whole world knows who he is. But back then, you see a skinny person, hardly has a beard. He's teaching Kabbalah, ichudim. He's saying that there's an angel coming to him and speaking to him. Magid. The few rabbanim that had Magid Mishamayim, Bet Yosef. There's a book, Magid Mesharim. It's the Malach that was speaking to Rabbi Yosef Karo, the writer of the Shulchan Aruch, the Gaon Mivilna. The Malachim saw that he reached such a level, they came to share with him divine knowledge. What did he answer? I want to get to it on my own in the right time. Don't want a gift. Let me get there in the right, as I'm progressing in my learning, I'll get there eventually. And he did. The Gemara in Masechet Chulin, Tzadik Aleph, the Gemara says like this, Tzadikim, Chaviv Alehem Mamonam Yoter Migufam. The Tzadikim, they love their money more than they love their body. Anybody here can explain to me, how did they dare to write such a thing in a Talmud? Is this praising the tzaddikim? Or is this chas v'shalom making fun? What do you think? If you come say, you know this chief rabbi? He loves money more than he loves his body. It sounds awful, no? So what do you think? You think Ravina and Rav Ashi, when they wrote the Talmud, they're going to write such a thing? No, obviously we don't understand what it means. Let's try again. What does it mean? Tzadikim chaviv aleim mamonam yoter migufam. They're willing to suffer all sufferings of the body to make sure that their money is pure and clean and doesn't have one penny of stolen money. No matter how much it will take, I will work, I will break my body to make sure that my money will be always clean and pure, and not $1 there would be stolen. That's what it means. Chaviv aleim mamonam yoter migufam means I want my money to be clean, that I don't have one penny is missing. For that, I'm willing to work all hard working jobs that possible to make sure that I don't have $1 that it's not mine. The Gemara says, Rish Lakish and Rabbi Yochanan. Rabbi Yochanan made Rish Lakish Baal Tshuva, and he became his chevruta eventually. One time Rabbi Yochanan could not learn. He asked him, what happened, Rabbi? He said, I was mugged. They stole my wallet. So he said to him, I cannot focus now. So Rish Lakish, who used to have a record, used to be a gangster before he became tzaddik, he went to the street. He knows who are in charge over there. He said, I'm giving you 1 hour to get the wallet of the rabbi back before the neighborhood will go on fire. He didn't say it. I made it a little bit more juicy. So he came to them. An hour later, he came back with a wallet. Rabbi, here's your wallet. So Rabbi Yochanan say, oh, Baruch Hashem, now I can learn. So the fools, what do they think? You see? Even the rabbi, he lost 200 bucks. He couldn't learn. So what do you want from me? I had a bad day at work yesterday. I cannot focus today. But that's the fools. The clever ones, they know right away what it means. Why Rabbi Yochanan couldn't learn? Because even the most simple Jew that I know in the whole world, an hour after he got mugged, he comes now to learn Gemara. 2 minutes after he opened the Gemara, he forgot about what happened. People have big problems, all kinds of problems in life, sicknesses, problem with children. When they're in the yeshiva, they learn like tigers. Eventually, when they close the book, the depression returns. But when they learn, they think about what's out there, nothing. The Torah takes away your mind completely from the problems. So what, Rabbi Yochanan? Somebody mugged him for a few hundred dollars so he couldn't learn? What's happening? The answer is nobody mug you, nobody rob you unless you yourself a thief. You have stolen money in your pocket. That's why Hashem sent the robber to me and not to him. Why he came to me? Why he didn't come to my friends? They were all there. Why from all the people in the street, they had to come to me and steal my wallet? That means I did something wrong. It did not give him rest. What did I do that I needed to lose all this money? Why? But then when Rish Lakish brought him back the wallet and he saw all the money is there, he had a relief. Baruch Hashem, it was only a nisayon from Hashem. I did not do anything wrong. Obviously, the money returned to me. If the money was stolen, it would never return to me. So that's how he relaxed. When he saw, that's the point, he cares about the money. One of the big rabbis said to his student, it says to them like that, "Ilu lo haya bachem avon, hayiti doeg alechem yoter." They ask him why. He said to them, "I know that you're making some sins. If I knew that you are not making any sin, I would worry about you even more." What's the pshat here? What's the common sense? You tell me. If the rabbi has students that are perfectly tzaddikim, perfect, and he has them that they make from time to time, they make sins. When should he be worried more about his students? When they make sins or when they don't make sins at all? So he said to them, when you're making now sins, if you would not make those sins, I would be even worry about you more. What, is he encouraging them to continue to make sins? The answer is no. If you would not make any sins, it for sure would lead you to a high level of pride. We are perfect. Pride is worse than the sins you make. Better you make one or two sins and not have your ego all the way up than to be perfect and to feel I'm a second HaKadosh Baruch Hu on the street. I don't make any sins. That's more dangerous. The ego, the pride is very, very dangerous. You should know, I say that a person should focus on being ma'avir al midotav. Fights. No problem. Take it. It's yours. No hard feeling. This is the style. Person should trust Hashem. Hashem knows who deserves what. What's the point of fighting? No problem. When you come in front of Hashem, the Satan would come and show all the bad that you did. Hashem say, no problem. Mida keneged mida. What do you want? Look what this person did to him. He said, let it go. Don't make anything. His wife said, Moshe, you have to retaliate. It's this, it's that. Let it go. No big deal at all. What's the point of instigating more and put more oil in the fire? What's the point? So it says, very interesting thing. Most of the fightings is based on mistakes. Did you know that? Almost all the fightings between people, some fightings is based on accurate information. Accurate. But most of the fights that a person did not have an accurate picture and the accurate information. If you really analyze the fight, how it started from nothing and how it became a world war, the answer is, you're going to see that it's based on many mistakes. Let me give you an example. Hashem said to the nation of Israel, "Al tidgaru b'Moav." Do not start a war against Moab. Balak didn't know it, that the Jews are forbidden to go and attack Moab. He was very worried. So he went to Bilam, to hire Bilam to help him against the Jews who are on the way to defeat him. But it was all false information. The Jews could never start a war with Balak. And Bilam that knew it, Bilam, he wanted the money and the kavod. So of course he didn't tell him, "Oh, you don't need my service. You don't need my service." Why? Because they have a restriction from their God not to attack you. So you have a shield. You don't need to pay me. Sometimes you come to a lawyer and you ask him something. He could tell you, "You don't need me. You go over here, you fill up the form, 2 minutes for free. Why you need? You don't need me for that." The opposite, through me, it's going to take longer. Or in a divorce cases, sometimes they're already ready to settle. But the lawyer knows if they settle, I'm going to lose a lot of money. So they create problems all the time to continue to charge. So going to them actually makes the divorce 100 times uglier. That's why I always tell people, you want to get divorced? Come to me, free of charge. 1 hour, you're done. No fighting, no lashon hara, you write a contract, finish. What do you need all this? 100,000, 50,000? One woman that I know from Florida, she got divorced from her husband. Guess how much they paid lawyer's fees for the divorce? Yes. Huh?
Quarter mil.
She paid 19 million and her husband paid 31 million. $50 million they paid to get divorced. How many yeshivot you can open for how many years for this stupid divorce that they had? And after all that, he died. The husband. Another year they wait, he'll die. They wouldn't have to get divorced. But, and one time I was in Beverly Hills, one woman came. She said, "The divorce is already taking 3 years. The lawyer does not let it finish. It's hundreds of times we're already to settle. He doesn't let. He goes, he makes problems. He already took from us one house. Now he took the second house. And the only house we have left is after that house also. What does he want me, to be on the street?" You understand? So most of the fights and the problems, they come from false information. We'll finish with one last thing for today. It says like this. Rav Chaim Sonnenfeld, this is what he says. He said the dogs in Mitzrayim, they got a very nice gift because they were quiet when Israel came out. They did not bark. So every generation, the Torah say, every time you slaughter something and became nevela, or you killed an animal and it became nevela, you thought, la kelef tashlichun oto, the price of the dogs, all the non-kosher slaughtering goes to them. That was before there was Muhammads that buy halal meat. Now, he used to throw it to the dogs. Now, it says, there's a question. Rav Chaim Sonnenfeld said, look what a beautiful idea. He says, what about the frogs? In Mitzrayim, the frogs jumped into the oven. They committed suicide for Hashem. They didn't scream Allahu Akbar. They just jumped into the oven. So, why the frogs did not get any gift from Hashem? There's no gift for the frogs. Nothing. They get nothing in the Torah. The dogs, they got the raw meat. But the dogs, the frogs, nothing. Why? So he said, this is the proof that sometimes to be quiet is harder than to talk. Why? When you have what to say and you're quiet, like Lot. Lot was quiet in front of Avram, in front of Paro. For that, Mashiach came from him. But when the people of Sodom came to rape his guest, Lot offered his daughter, offered himself, make a big deal, was risking his life, almost no reward. But one minute he was next to Paro with Avraham, and he did not say, "Oh, you made a mistake. She's your wife. She's not your sister." He could have got all the millions, but he was quiet. For that, the Mashiach come from him. To be quiet is not easy. But I'll finish with one thing. I told you that. Look, listen to this. It says like this. We can add to that, when you do mitzvah, Hashem also look what came out of it. When he gives the reward, he also see what came out of it. When the dogs did not bark, the Jews came out of Mitzrayim. They got the Torah. They went to Eretz Israel. They built Bet HaMikdash. Lots of wonderful things happened. So the fact that the dogs did not bark got the nation of Hashem a lot of wonderful things. The frogs that jumped into the fire, what came out of it? Nothing. Paro continued. Nothing happened. Nothing came out of it from their sacrifice. In the end, in reality, the Jewish nation did not benefit from that. Paro should have learned. Look at the frogs. They're jumping into the fire because Hashem said so. But Paro didn't learn anything. So the frogs, for whatever reason, they did not help the Jewish nation in any way. They got nothing from Hashem. The dogs helped the Jewish nation. All the raw meat that is not kosher, you have to throw to the dogs. So we see the same thing in tzedakah. Prophet Yirmiyahu say to Hashem, the stingy Jews that do not give tzedakah, if finally they want to give tzedakah once in a while, make sure to send them the crooks, that the crooks will take away their tzedakah. Why? Who cares who takes the tzedakah? You want to give tzedakah, you give tzedakah, finish. No. What came out of the tzedakah is very, very important. That's why the prophet say to Hashem, finally, when this evil person agree to write a check, make sure the gambler come and take it. And from there, from his house, directly to the casino in Jamaica here. I heard the open casino here. Yeah. Yes. Few more other families broken since then. People go lose money there. It's cancer. This gambling is cancer. What's the drug sometimes? Once a person starts with that, Hashem irachem. So we have now a few more days to Yom Kippur. Remember, we have to do tshuva between mitzvot ben adam lechavero. If a person does not ask mechila from all the people that he hurt, he's not going to have mechila in Yom Kippur. Remember this. It's not just speeches. It's reality. You have to ask mechila from your in-laws. They did a lot for you. Don't be ungrateful. Even if you write about the point, what do you care? Go make peace from the neighbors, from brothers, from sisters, even from your own children, and definitely from your wife or from your husband. People have to learn. If you're not going to ask mechila, some poskim say, even mechila between you and Hashem you don't have. Even from goyim. If you did something wrong to the goy, you have to ask him for mechila. Of course, why? Why the goy, you're not allowed to steal from the goy. You're not allowed to trick the goy in a business. You're not allowed to instigate fights and to create chilul Hashem. Even a goyim. Actually, it's big kiddush Hashem. If you come to a Chris or to Muhammad and say, listen, now it's Yom Kippur. We're standing in front of Hashem. He's going to judge us. What I did to you was wrong. I want to ask you for apology. Please forgive me. I hope I'll never do it again. Do you know what a big kiddush Hashem it is? He's going to go now and say to Fatma, his wife, and she's going to say to her 50 sisters, and they're going to say to the 500 friends, and it's going to go to half of the world. What do you think? The news traveled very fast. When the Chafetz Chaim wanted to send a message to town, there was no Facebook yet. So he called the two neighbors, the friends of his wife. He called them in. It was Erev Shabbat. Few hours before Shabbat, he wants the whole town to know. So he said, I want to tell you a story, but I want you to promise not to tell to anyone. It's a very big secret. He said the story to his wife. He let those two ladies hear. Three ladies heard that. It's more efficient than Facebook. Everyone in town by Shabbat already knew the news. Why? Go and tell the person, I tell you a secret, but make sure not to tell anyone. What's the first thing the Satan does? To him, it's okay. To him, it's also okay. To him, it's also okay. And all the world knows. Baruch Adonai Leolam. Amen v'amen. Thank you.